This morning, we're at Riverfront Park in Salem for Bridgeway's 6th annual Run for Recovery. We've been doing this in honor of people struggling with symptoms of mental illness and symptoms of addiction.
I'm running the 5K, which is the first time I'm doing this, and I'm actually a graduate of Bridgeway.
Statistics tell us every one of us either has some personal experience or family experience or friends that struggle with symptoms of addiction and mental illness.
We drove down from Portland today to run the 10K here in honor of our friend Richard, who passed away just a week ago, and to honor our friends that are still stuck in addiction.
It's absolutely amazing, full of excitement. You never know what the day is going to bring. Meeting people, being out here, talking to people in the community, it's absolutely extraordinary. It's one of the most fulfilling, rewarding things I've ever done in my whole life. And being a part of it, I really do feel so incredibly grateful.
Sometimes when I'm on the truck, people come up and they say, oh, I just want you to know I'm really grateful for Bridgeway and the people that work there, because my brother was in addiction for 40 years. He came to detox and he got help, and he's been doing good for 2 years now. And people really, they want to hug you and thank you, and so they want to support Bridgeway. And I'm an addict in recovery, so that means a really lot that I get to see that we're actually helping people.
Hello, welcome back to InSight. I'm Wendy Brokaw. And today we are going to be talking about one of the most difficult subjects of all, addiction. And there is a group that has done a wonderful job getting people to address it, to get over the fears of it, and to recover from it. We're talking to Tim Murphy. He is the head of Bridgeway Recovery Services. Thank you for joining us.
Great, thanks for inviting me. It's a pleasure.
You know, you've just done your Run for Recovery run. It's a wonderful event every year. We got great interviews and video with people, and that got me thinking, what is Bridgeway Recovery? And you go to your website, and it says it's a new kind of healthcare paradigm, really. Mm-hmm. And tell us about it.
So, sure, that's great. Thanks for asking. So, Bridgeway Recovery Services, I started that organization in 2009. So, we've been here about 10 years. It's one of Salem, Marion County's best kept little stories. It started as a really small organization, but has grown to be a pretty significant provider of mental health services and chemical dependency services for people from adolescence all through adulthood struggling, suffering with symptoms of mental illness or symptoms of addiction. We have 8 sites that we deliver services in the Marion County area, and we draw most of the folks that come in are from the Marion and Polk counties, but we also have some services that are statewide. So we might get people from Bend or from Southern Oregon, from the Portland area that come down to work with us. And one of the things that's different about Bridgeway, it's all voluntary as far as the patients go. So you can't be mandated to treatment. You can't be forced into treatment. You might be told you need to go to treatment, but you can't be told you have to come to Bridgeway. So everybody that comes there of their own free will. None of our programs are locked. They're all open so people can come. We really do our best to engage with them so they'll stay and really benefit from the services. And almost 85-89% of the time they do. So we're really successful with people once we start talking with them.
I love the fact that just before the program began, you were talking about we're ready, when you're ready, we'll be there for you.
Yeah, it's sort of one of our kind of slogans that we have is that when you're ready, we'll be there for you. And you'll see that on billboards in town, and you'll see some other advertisement around that piece, because it's important in our field that you come in willingly and that you engage yourself and say, I'm struggling with some things. I'd like some help in figuring out how to have a more successful life. And addiction and symptoms of mental health really can interfere with quality of life for people. And we also do problem gambling treatment for people that are struggling with gambling behaviors as a result of Oregon State Lottery games or casinos, that sort of thing. And we can definitely make some inroads in those behaviors if people really want that help.
So just to recap, what are the actual areas of your service?
Sure. Sure. So outpatient services for chemical dependency, addiction, outpatient services for symptoms of mental health, mental illness, so people with depression, trauma, ADHD, anxiety disorders can come and work with us, our counselors, if they wish to. We have a medical team as well that can prescribe medicine if necessary. And then for folks who are struggling a little bit more with symptoms, we have residential programs. So we have a residential chemical dependency program for women. We call it the Sandra Bloom House, named after a famous psychiatrist friend of mine, and that's out in Staten. We have the Freedom House, which is an 8-bed residential program for men also struggling with symptoms of chemical dependency. And we have our Sandy M House, and that's a house dedicated to treating people with problem gambling behaviors. So those are our core services. We also have a primary care clinic, so people that are engaged with us for chemical dependency or mental health, but also have some primary care health needs, they can come and get those health needs met with us too.
You have more than 30 years experience in this particular field.
Oh, did you have to say that?
No, but that's the thing. What brought you to Bridgeway to bring your vast background? And for those of people out in the audience that don't know, Tim is one of the founders of Liberty House.
Yeah, I've had a really
assessment center. Nice, that's amazing history.
Nice, successful time. I moved to Oregon in 1992 from California. I had a private practice in Beverly Hills and some other work that I did down there, but came up here to live in the real world, and it's been great. It's been 27 years of being an Oregonian, and I really enjoy it. And I worked with Marion County Health Department when I first arrived as a child and family therapist. I'm a child and family therapist trained professional. And then was asked to go to Salem Hospital, and I worked there for 8 years, developing psychiatric medical programs for both in beginning kids. And then I was the administrative director of psychiatric medicine for Salem Hospital for a number of years. And then wrote a book while I was there, and that book propelled a 2 years of going out and lecturing and training other organizations to do some of the work that we had done here. That landed me in Hawaii. I spent 2 years in Hawaii as the CEO of Maui Youth and Family Services, and that was a great gig. If anyone ever offers you a job in Hawaii, take it. But I had a home here, and I always wanted to get back to Oregon, so I came back in 2008. At that time, was asked to build a new service program for people with chemical dependency and behavioral health issues. There was a pre-existing program called Bridgeway that was owned by an Oregon-based or a Portland-based company. And so what I did is rebuilt that organization, kept the name Bridgeway because it had really good reputation in the community, and started with 40 people in one clinic, and now we have 150 employees and 7 different sites where we get to serve all of our community in a variety of ways. It's been great. It's a really good story.
All right. Let us talk about why it works, because everybody knows, and one of the toughest things to deal with is the stigma associated with, I have a problem.
Yeah.
And I'm scared. And people start there. Start with the stigma of that whole thing and
so
how
when,
you deal
Wendy,
with
you
that.
Just identified one of the biggest barriers for people getting into treatment. It's that issue of stigma. The unwillingness or the uncomfortableness of admitting that you have a problem in your life that might be connected to mental health or might be connected to addiction. Maybe it's alcohol, maybe it's prescription medicine, maybe it's street drugs. And so as a society, we've always sort of shunned folks with addictions. We have marginalized that population of people. We have, we haven't been successful in accepting the fact that mental illness affects such a large segment of our society. So we do our best to be really public. So you'll see by intention billboards in town for Bridgeway. We have a campaign now called Bridgeway Strong, and you'll see that throughout the community. And sort of making the message that it takes strength to admit that you need help or that you want help. And if you come to Bridgeway and ask for help, you'll get that help you need. So we're trying to break down stigma in that way. Every other week, we've been at Saturday Market and the Wednesday Market. We have a booth. A couple of years ago, I bought a food truck, not so much in because I wanted a food truck, but I wanted a vehicle to put people out in the community. Everybody who works on the Bridgeway food truck, which is called the Rolling Bridgeway Cafe, is a graduate from our program. And sometimes people, when they've graduated from a rehab program, have difficulty finding a job. So we built this as a vehicle for people to get work. And also, while you're at the Bridgeway Cafe, the Rolling Bridgeway Cafe, ordering a sandwich, the food's excellent. There's brochures there for detox. There's brochures there for mental health. There's resources available in the community available to you. And we know by doing that, we can address the stigma issue for some people, and we can help people get connected to services that they're looking for.
When it
and
comes-
you have a great sandwich while you're doing it.
You heard it here. Well, how do you seal the deal with getting past the stigma with people who aren't looking in the community?
That's a really good question. So most people, when they come in, about two-thirds of the people that walk in our door, they're coming in for the first time. So we've trained all of our staff, from the people who answer the phone, the people at the reception desk, people mowing the lawn, the people making the food for the food truck, in the effects of trauma on the people that are struggling. So all of our staff, clinical staff and our support staff, all have some understanding and training. And so they work really hard to make you feel comfortable when you arrive, see to it that you need anything. Nobody asks what's wrong with you, why are you here? It's more, how can I help you? What do you need? What's happened to you that, you know, in your life? And that's a bit of a more of a clinical approach, but it's a welcoming environment. We have great art in our waiting rooms. I go to the art fair every year in Salem, and I look for something new to buy, and I put it in one of our waiting rooms, and we've been able to do that. So what our patients tell us is they feel respected by coming to Bridgeway. They feel welcome, and they feel engaged. And that keeps people coming back. Another struggle that we have with people with symptoms of addiction and mental health is staying in treatment.
Uh-huh.
You know, they'll initially start treatment, but keeping them in treatment. And we do a lot of work to keep people engaged so they stay in treatment, look for those solutions that add back quality of life that they may have lost along the way.
And do they come back over a long period of time?
Yeah, well, we see people episodically. So people will come in, maybe they work with us for 6-8 weeks, and they can leave and be successful. And then maybe a year down the road, they decide, you know, I've got this another issue I'd like to go, and Bridgeway helped me, I'm going to go back and see if I can get help with that. So we see that quite a bit. We also have an event once a year where we invite anybody that's gone through Bridgeway to come back and see us. And we just did that in September this year, and we had hundreds of people come for this large barbecue that we put on. And it's sometimes our clients, patients, want us to see how well they're doing. Sometimes they're coming back seeking, hey, when I was in treatment with this guy, George. Is George here? Maybe I'll see George again. And they see each other. And then our therapists and counselors and nurses and our docs, they see folks that have gone through treatment. They leave, and, you know, oftentimes you don't see them again because they're doing really well. But they'll come back to this event, and we get to see how well people are doing. It's really heartwarming. And, you know, and some people come back, and they're still struggling, but they come back. They remember being connected to Bridgeway, and that's a really positive thing.
And that's completely over the stigma. It's using your services.
That's how you break stigma down. That's how you do it, is you're available, you're accessible, you're respectful, and you're there.
And it makes the hard work that inevitably goes into recovering from anything a lot easier.
Yeah, and recovery's a long road. You know, struggling with addiction, it's not so much what you're addicted to, it's why you got addicted in the first place. Ah. It's not the heroin or the alcohol, it's the pain that's causing you to use heroin or alcohol. So we want to really get to why the pain. Not why the drug, but why the pain. And I think that's also true for people struggling with symptoms of mental illness. What's the cause of that? How can we help you with that? What do you know about it? And do you have an understanding of why you're struggling? And because it's one thing for a professional to say why they think you might be struggling. It's a whole other thing for you to understand why you're struggling. And that's where the cure is. That's where things get better for people.
before we end this conversation, which I would love to continue much more, because it's so big. It's such a huge topic, and I may actually ask you back sometime.
That would be fine.
But what I'd really like to know is, at the moment, the opioid crisis. Do you have any input on that and what effect that's having on our community?
The opioid crisis is real, and it's huge, and there's multiple factors that have caused it. So there isn't a single cause, and there's not a single solution. But there's a widespread, we don't like pain. People do not like pain. And for years, we did everything we could to help people manage their pain and eliminate their pain. And some of those decisions that we made to help people eliminate their pain contributed to the opioid crisis we have today by using opioid-based painkillers to help people manage their pain, not realizing the iatrogenic effect, the solution caused a bigger problem than you were having initially by the pain of addiction that comes with it. So it's going to take us a while to work ourselves out of that, but there's so much awareness and recognition that I'm really hopeful about it. The opioid addict of 20 years ago, which was always this picture of this heroin addict shriveled under a bridge selling drugs, is not the opioid addict of today.
What is
today? It's a professional. It's your neighbor. It's the person in church with you. It's your aunt. It's your sister that may be struggling with real pain that they've tried to medicate using opioid medicine, and as a result, developed a dependence on that medicine. And so now we're trying to figure out ways to relieve them from that dependence. And yet not return them to pain.
All this seems revolving around pain, the whole story.
Yeah, it does. It is. Emotional pain, psychiatric pain, physical pain. You know, that's somewhat of our plight as humans, and none of us like it. And particularly the emotional pain and the pain of humiliation, the pain of fear, those are so intolerable we'll do anything to not feel them. And, you know, this is where we get.
I love the fact that so many people have shown up for the barbecue once a year. Hundreds of people reconnecting with each other.
I think we had 250 this last year.
Oh, my gosh.
It's amazing, yeah.
If somebody wants to get in touch with you, you have a website. Could you give it, please?
We do. It's bridgewayrecovery.com. And you can go on there. We also have Facebook pages. We've got Instagram. We've got somebody tweets for Bridgeway every now and then. So we're pretty available to find out about it. We have some videos on our website, talk a little bit about what we do and the services we provide. Many of us that work for Bridgeway are out in the community giving talks similar to this one, and so it's great to be part of it. And Salem's a great community. We've been really well received and welcomed for the services we provide.
Well, after 10 years, you certainly are building the organization, and you've just given InSight viewers an insight as to why it works.
Well, I'm really honored to be on your show and to be part of the InSight viewers, so thank you for the time.
Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.
This has been Tim Murphy. He is the CEO of Bridgeway Recovery Services. Thank you for joining us today on InSight. I'm Wendy Brokaw. We'll see you next time.